I'm Anna Berry. I am the co-chair of the diversity committee here at the college, as well as a coordinator of disability services. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker this afternoon, and it couldn't be more appropriate to introduce a man whose life is full of music, full of education, and full of community service. Paul Dedell is an educator in Brattleboro, Vermont, where he teaches middle school students. And if y'all know middle school students, you either love them or you hate them. Paul loves them, and he is a master at bringing out the best in children. He leads a trip every other year to Alabama, where they do a real-life, week-long study of the civil rights movement. He was a little bit shocked that he would have to speak in front of a group today, and then he said, if my middle school students can do it, so can I. So I'd like to introduce Paul Dedell. Thank you.
Thank you for having me today. It's a real privilege and honor to be here. As Anna said, my name is Paul Dedell, and I'm the director of the middle school adolescent program at Hilltop Montessori School in Brattleboro, Vermont. And 2 years ago, on Martin Luther King Day, my class was presented with the Bright Lights Award. And they didn't receive this award due to community service projects, although they're a pretty involved group. And they didn't receive the award for a lifetime of commitment to justice, because after all, they're just 12 to 14 years old. And they certainly didn't receive the award for some kind of greater sacrifice. All in all, they're a pretty comfortable and fortunate group of kids. They were presented with the Bright Lights Award for their dedication and responsibility to their own learning, their immersion of thought, and the voice they bring to that thought. They received the award because they dared to take intellectual and emotional risks and think critically and independently. And that is what I want to talk about today, how education, particularly a Montessori education, can be a path toward social justice. As I said, we are a Montessori school. The primary guiding philosophy of all Montessori schools from around the world is to teach peace. As Maria Montessori said, it is quite strange that as of yet, there is not such a thing as a science of peace, since the science of war seems to be highly advanced. So how is it that we teach peace? In the middle school, we follow the essential question, what does it mean to be human? We pursue this question from many different directions across different disciplines, from every angle we can find. The thought is that the more we understand who we are in our society, in our environment, in our world, the better equipped we will be to become agents of positive change. Our country does not look highly upon critical thinking, critical questioning, and most certainly critical empathy. The world is painted in a very particular way through popular culture and media, and it makes it very challenging for students to look at the world the way that Dr. King and so many others embraced, and that's through the eyes of the beloved community. So what does all this have to do with celebrating the life of Dr. King? As part of our two-year curriculum of exploring what does it mean to be human, we look at the concept of struggle, especially in American history. We examine the American Revolution, the rise of industry, and the concurrent rise of organized labor, the growing pains and the casualties of expansion, and the history of slavery in this country. The arc brings us to an intensive study of the civil rights movement. But before we jump into the Montgomery bus boycott and Dr. King's meteoric involvement in the movement, we read slave journals. We discuss the Dred Scott case. We try to fathom Reconstruction and the Jim Crow laws. We recognize Plessy versus Ferguson as the legalization of segregation. We watch Birth of a Nation and are breathless at the portrayal of African Americans and the fact that the then president, Woodrow Wilson, praised that film for its realism and its sentiment. We then jump forward into the story of the movement and were inspired by Atticus Finch in To Kill a Mockingbird with his exhortation to walk in someone else's shoes. To that end, we don't only read Dr. King's letter from Birmingham jail or I Have a Dream speech, but we also read the words of people who lived and believed in segregation. It is so easy to point the finger. We point the finger at the Southerners, the segregationists, the bigots, the bad guys, the terrorists. It's so easy to also lose the entire reason for Dr. King's nonviolent march to justice. That is, by striving for the rights and freedom of the oppressed, we are also freeing the oppressor by relieving them of their fear, guilt, and anger. That we can't, as Maya Angelou said in a speech delivered in honor of Dr. King, separate ourselves from being human. We can't separate ourselves from other humans. That we are all capable of great nobility and degrading evil. As a way for the class to totally immerse themselves into not only the history of the civil rights movement, but also its legacy and its continuance, we journey to Alabama, a real odyssey, to meet and talk with all sorts of people, including some of the icons of the movement, such as Dr. Reverend Fred Shuttlesworth, Representative John Lewis, the late Reverend James Bevel, and also foot soldiers, my favorite being Colonel Stone Johnson. Colonel Stone Johnson was Reverend Shuttlesworth's bodyguard in Birmingham and saved him a number of times from the KKK's dynamite. And also the late Johnny Carr from Montgomery. Johnny was Rosa Parks' best friend, and she was one of the original organizers of the bus boycott. Bob Mance, a former SNCC member and a Black Panther member in the violent-ridden Lowndes County, who was a good friend of Stokely Carmichael's and Jonathan Daniels of Keene before he was murdered in 1965. We journeyed to G's Bend, Alabama, famous for its quilts, but even more profound in that almost all of its residents share the same surname, the name of their owner in former slavery times, a living legacy. We spend a Sunday together, we go to church, we have a picnic, we sing, we share speeches and stories. We also meet and talk to individuals who are continuing the struggle to this day. Selma's schools today are as segregated now as they were during those turbulent years. All in all, it's pretty heady material for Vermont 7th and 8th graders. So what do you do with all this experience? This brings us back to the Bright Lights Award and our being here 2 years ago. Our students synthesized their individual and collective experience through the creation of a performance that's not a travelogue, but a reflection. Not a recreation of the historical record, but a profoundly personal look into racism, exclusion, and the human spirit. A powerful expression of critical, independent thinkers and emerging citizens, seen and heard through the lens of theater and song. 2 years ago, we came and we sang some of those songs at this ceremony, and I felt like the best way I could express the importance of an education that fosters critical thinking, compassion, empathy, and community. An education which I believe is the best way to continue Doctor's dream of a beloved community is to share some of those songs with you today. So that's what I'm going to do. We've been to Alabama 4 times. It's been truly extraordinary because I feel like I have some of my best friends there. And every time students come back and they're changed. They're changed people. The immersion into a culture that's so unlike our own, and especially at this time of year, it's actually reasonably warm down there, that they move into new levels of thought. And I think in some ways, for us at Hilltop Montessori School, we do so much through the creative lens as a way to explore our feelings, the way to explore our learning. And I'm going to do a couple of these songs. This first song. Oftentimes, a student will take this experience, and as they synthesize it, they'll bring some of those icons, those kind of pieces of the movement that they can relate to, whether it's the Children's March or the sit-down. In fact, today is the 50th anniversary of the Woolworths. 50 years ago, it was in Woolworths in North Carolina. It was the very first time we had the lunch counter sit-in. And they'll use those pieces as their kind of stepping points and then try to move that into a personal place. And this is a song called They Still Hold Fast. Walk into a cafe and there's nothing going on. Then a man goes to the counter
and he says there's something wrong. There's a band of blacks approaching, and they're coming in the door. They say that they want service and get beaten to the floor. Yet they still hold fast. Yes, they still hold fast, 'cause this movement's built to last, and they're just not gonna give in awful fast. I'm just standing on the sidewalk, not doing much at all, when there's shouts behind some houses, and I answer to the call. There's a march out on the highway, and they are letting loose the gas. There are clubs and there is screaming, and there's blood upon the grass. Yet they still hold fast. Yes, they still hold fast, 'cause this movement's built to last, and they just are not going to give in awful fast. I am standing by my window in my house beside the park, when I hear the water hoses and a German shepherd's bark. There are children getting blasted, getting carried off in droves. Anyone who tries to run is bit and knocked down by the hose. Yet they still hold fast. Yes, they still hold fast, 'cause this movement's built to last, and they just are not going to give in awful fast. Though it's been many years and many tears since the problems in this song, I can still walk through the city and see the problems are not gone. There's still fighting in the streets and racial problems in the schools. Black power is still lurking, and the Klan does not know rules. Yet they still hold fast. Yes, they still hold fast, 'cause this movement's built to last, and they just are not going to give in awful fast. No, they just are not going to give in awful fast.
Thank you. So, thank you. As I was saying in the speech about how students, we really go with Atticus Finch to walk in other people's shoes. And this is a song called Life Just Isn't Fair. It comes from a point of view of when you're on top, that's where you want to stay. And in fact, you'll do anything to stay there. And so this song tends to reflect the movement, but it also tends to reflect very much a human impulse. And you'll hear references that are also kind of more current. I gotta tell you this. These students sometimes go in pretty wild places. This last year, when we just came back from Alabama, when we were creating our performance, one of the pieces that some of the students came up with was a Ku Klux Klan rap. Now, so they put this together. It was a pretty extraordinary piece of rhyming. This one guy was an extraordinary beatboxer, and they had this outrageous rap. And it was not sensitive, let's put it this way. You know, not PC, that's for sure. To the point that parents were just out of their minds. Just like, how could you allow students to explore that? Students shouldn't be going up there in their, there they were, these three students, they're eighth graders for God's sakes, and they have their white robes on, and they're all very serious, and all of a sudden the beatbox up, and they whip off their hoods, and they start doing this rap. And what parents and other people could not find and couldn't figure out was the irony that these students were creating, taking a hate group, a white supremacist group, and using historically African-American musical form to explore the ridiculousness of the hate supremacist group. It was really hard for them. It was a big leap. And it's because
we get so stuck. We're so stuck in the realm of, you know, it's got to be this way. Our students should think this way. They should always behave in this manner. And it doesn't allow them the opportunity to really explore those ironies in human existence in our lives. So this song is also, I think, a terrific way to follow it, too. So this one was a sort of a little doo-wop group they had going up on stage called Life Just Isn't Fair.
Everything's in order until they come up to the border. Everything is right until they scratch and bite. Life just isn't fair. But we're on the top and we'll stay up there. If you ask me why, I'll say life just isn't fair. I swear I love each black man and always hate the Klan. I respect every single race as long as they stay in their place. Life just isn't fair. But we're on the top and we'll stay up there. If you ask me why, I'll say life just isn't fair. We may sing the same old prayer, we may pay the same bus fare, but if you bring up equality, miss it as frivolity. Life just isn't fair. But we're on the top and we'll stay up there. If you ask me why, I'll say life just isn't fair. I know you all face terror, but it's really not my error. You can't escape from strife unless it helps my life. Life just isn't fair.
I hope you can help join in there. But I'm going to sing another one again using some iconic images. This is from last year.
Sick and tired he was, back of the bus. Sitting in the back was never his wish. One day he stood and decided not to budge. That was his one downfall and his final stand. His one downfall and final stand. So angered she was, she had no vote. No voice at all, you see. She marched to the office and took the test. That was her one downfall and her final stand. Her one downfall and final stand. The fight was long. Others hid their heads in shame. Some gave their home and even their lives. Some ran away and tried to hide. And after fighting for so long, had finally won the fight. They stood together, so tall, so proud, on the bridge of freedom. Then they crossed. crossed on over to the other side. It was their victory and their final stand. Their victory and final stand.
Really be great. I'd like to just finish up. I'd like to see if we could do. You can help me sing this one. It's a song called Someday. And it was interesting, this was a trip from a couple times ago. When you go to Alabama, as I said in the speech, you really are kind of going back into a place that hasn't changed that much in some ways. You think when you read the books and you study the movements and you cross the bridge from Selma to Montgomery and you march the 50 miles and there was Dr. King doing that speech and you think, good story, all done. Great, we came, we crossed that bridge, and we crossed the bridge physically, and emotionally, and spiritually, and it's all done. And the fact is, when you're in the South, it's not. Still a lot of bridges going on. And one time we were there, and we were staying at this youth conference center that was built for African-American youth leadership. And the day before we got there, it had been vandalized. All the copper pipe had been stolen from it, and racial epithets were strewn everywhere, painted all over the buildings. And here I was in Selma, Alabama, nowhere to go, and there was this. They said, you can come, but there's no water, because all is gone, and you're in this face of this kind of frightening place. So the good teacher that I try to be, here's a learning situation, right? An opportunity to walk right into it. And so there we were. It was a very, it was disconcerting, it was scary. But so there we were in the midst of the ongoing movement. And we worked with these folks, we had clean up, we just did our Selma thing. And so this song kind of comes out of that experience, and I'll show you why. Here's the chorus I'd like you to join me with.
Someday we'll all be equal, but that day has yet to come.
Try that.
Someday we'll all be equal, but that day has yet to come.
So it really reflects this. There's a level of disappointment in these students sometimes when they get faced with the inevitability of human nature, and they try to always to maintain that level of hope and what that human spirit represents is a big part of learning, and it's a big part of becoming a critical thinker. So in this song, the last time we sing that chorus, we'll kind of move beyond that. We'll go to this, we'll go, someday we'll all be equal in that day, and that day we'll live as one. Someday.
How it started, no one knows, but we know it can't be right. A black man cowers away when there is a white man in his sight. In humanity, there should be no hate between black and white. Someday we'll all be equal, but that day has yet to come. The day did come, it had taken so long, it was time for them to fight. To tumble that tower of injustice, to rebuild it how they might. To seize the chance for freedom while it was in their sight. Someday we'll all be equal, but that day has yet to come. Shots rang out and bodies dropped. It was a gruesome day for all, and many died from every side to answer freedom's call. The battle raged every day because the walls had to fall. I pray for those who fought that fight for what they knew was right. We have work to do, we can't give up, keep freedom in our sight. Do we see with brand new eyes, and will we continue the
comes great hope, and I believe the course of the future is molded in education, and an education that gives us the tools we need to become true independent thinkers. Thank you for having me.